Hi, everybody. I'm so glad to be here. As Amanda said, today I'm going to be talking to you about superusers, why they're so important, and what you can and should be doing to make sure that your organization is getting more than your fair share of this very limited resource. Introducing the superuser. The superuser is that customer that you have that does more than their fair share of bringing in new customers for you. They're the ones that know and love your brand. They know your product. They use it well. They use it frequently. And when I say they use it well, I mean they use it in the way that you'd like for all your customers to use it. They understand the features and the functionality, the reasons you designed the product, and they want to share that with other people and spread the word. They give good feedback. They're supportive. These are the people you really want to have in your community. This is an example of a super user. This happens to be my sister, and if you can't read the writing on her shirt, it says, "The sport of old broads kicking your ass has arrived." And she's a CrossFitter. Are there any CrossFitters in the crowd today? No, you wouldn't have time to come to this if you were a CrossFitter. She goes 3 times a week to her CrossFit classes. She runs a CrossFit driveway in front of her house on days when the box, which is what they call their studio, when the box is closed, there's CrossFit driveway in front of my sister's house. She invites her peers to come over and use that. She writes a blog, and she does all of this in addition to her full-time job. If she were here right now, she'd probably be talking to you, extolling the virtues of CrossFit, telling you that she herself was not an athlete, it's really for anybody, maybe even suggesting some ways you could change your eating habits so that you could be healthier. So that's really a super user in a nutshell. So how do you define a super user and why do they matter? Well, super user exhibits 3 basic traits. The first one is they know and love the product. They understand the brand. The second one is they are engaged and motivated to help you help your other customers. And they're motivated to give you useful feedback because they want to improve the experience for everybody. And the third thing about super users is they're involved in advocacy. They are evangelists, bringing in new customers, and even onboarding them, so making them feel welcome when they join, helping them understand the ropes, learn about the culture, and become part of the community. And it's that stickiness that brings in and keeps customers happy. So super users are not just a phenomenon among consumer products companies and health businesses. It's very, very big in SaaS, and I bet a lot of you are thinking about how your customers might be super users. One of the companies that really sort of is leading the charge and driving the wave is the one that we were just talking about with George Hugh, Salesforce. Salesforce, fourth year now that they've been voted the most innovative company in the world by Forbes. It's groundbreaking, and I think a big part of the reason that they are so successful is because they understand that behind B2B, there's always a C. There's always a consumer. There's always a human being who needs to be recognized, needs to belong, needs to be successful. And it's that focus and the investment that they've made in understanding that that has really made them different from the software companies that came before them and that has really allowed them to serve as the role model for the many companies that are following them. They have a program that I'm sure many of you are familiar with, the MVP program. This is a perfect example of how to create super users. They call this program their way of recognizing people who contribute excellence to the community. And these are people who help others learn how to use their products. They speak at events that Salesforce puts on. They wear logo wear with pride. They give great feedback to the company. And you know what they get as a reward when they become an MVP? They get the opportunity to do more of that stuff. They get greater access to senior leaders. They get more opportunities to speak. They get introductions to their peers. And they get more free logo wear. And, you know, it's interesting because people are very proud to be part of this MVP community. It's a source of status, and it's also a place where they can belong. So it's a very, very smart strategy for connecting with the human beings behind the businesses and also a way of engaging them to actually improve the situation of the company. So these super users are especially important because they're driving what I call the membership economy. And the membership economy is a term that I coined to describe what I've been seeing over the last 11 years or so. It's this massive change from ownership to access, from transactional to relational, and from an attitude of meeting your anonymous customer one time to knowing your customer and seeing them many times. And it's changing every industry. I mean, here today we're mostly in software, but it's changing the way that people are doing professional services, the way small businesses run, music, news, all kinds of content, the way that loyalty programs are happening, and we're starting to see it with consumer packaged goods companies, where they're trying to actually make a direct connection to their customers and build an ongoing relationship with them. And the reason that it's happening, part of it is that technology is enabling what I call the extension of the infrastructure of trust, which basically means that because of new advances in technology, things like mobile devices, the declining cost of storage, the ability to serve up user-generated content and so on, people are able to feel more connected across greater distances. And that's really enabling the membership economy. But the principles of membership are timeless. It's always appealed to businesses because every business wants predictable recurring revenue. We all want to have a golden goose so that we don't have to worry about where the cash is going to come from, and instead we can focus on better serving our customers and developing great products. It also, though, appeals to the human beings, to the customers. And that's the part that I think people don't always realize. We all want to belong. We all want to feel safe. We want to be recognized by our peers for what's good and special about us. We want to be recognized for the contributions we make and for helping others. And ultimately, we want to be proud of ourselves. We want to achieve things and have our work matter. And that's true in our personal lives, and it's also true in our business lives. And so, you know, it's really why we do most things. It's why we join organizations, and it's why we volunteer our time to help others. It's why we join sororities and fraternities. It's at least part of the reason that people go to church. And I'm just going to digress for a minute and tell you about one church that is really taking advantage of the membership economy. That's the Lakewood Church in Houston, Texas. Anybody here from Houston? Yeah, go to, and does anybody know Joel Osteen's church there? 45,000 people come through his church every Sunday. That's physical. 45,000 people go to those three services every Sunday morning. In addition, they live stream their sermons, and they have a huge website and online community which does all kinds of things for their members, including if you have a problem and you need somebody to pray for you. You can actually go online and find people and ask them to pray for you, and they have an online prayer community. So they've really stretched that infrastructure of trust and built a group of super users that really spans the globe. Another place where we see membership and we see people, you know, we've always seen people feeling connected is with sports teams. Go Warriors. You know, the fact that you can fill a stadium with 50 or 100,000 people, many of whom have never played the game and don't know any of the players, and have them feel such an affinity for those people, and even feeling an affinity for the people they're sitting next to and the other people wearing the t-shirts, is really quite an amazing thing. And I'm giving you these examples because I want you to think about how to apply this to your own company and how to arouse these kinds of feelings of pride and loyalty and desire to connect and help your peers with your customers. And that's really a big challenge because there's a lot of different organizations that are competing for the time and attention of your customers. So this is really the challenge. How do you identify these people that could be your super users? And how do you create an environment where they say, you know, I'm going to devote my time and energy to learning about your company, to giving you feedback, to connecting with my peers that are using these products also, to coming to your annual meetings and events, and to maybe even bringing in my peers, the other people that have my job and that might benefit from your products. How do we do that? So there's three ways that you can find and then support your super users. The first one is you want to remove all friction from their first experience with you. So I am, this is not news, but I am amazed at how difficult it is to get started with most SaaS products. The companies often say that it's easy, but the actual experience after the transaction is completed of onboarding, getting people up and running, getting the data before you actually get a payoff can be really tiresome and challenging. And you have to remember that that's the first time that they're getting the experience. And you know, in many cases, the person that's going to use the product is not the person who bought it. And so there's all kinds of room to lose even the most excited and engaged people before they even have a chance to get engaged. I did not mean to do that. So the other two things that you would want to do for engaging your super users are, second, you want to give them a taste of value right away. So one company I work with, TransFX, is an online translation company that translates websites and digital products for companies. And they used to have a process where you'd sign up, it was very quick, you'd sign up, no friction, and you could immediately start engaging in a product, but you had to have a translator. So most people don't have a translator, like most developers don't have a translator standing by to, you know, translate it into Greek or French or Mandarin. And so the process was difficult, and they often didn't really get a taste of how cool the technology was. In their second iteration, what they did is they created a way that you could put just a little string, a little line of code into your website, and you could pick a language, and they would use a translation engine like a Google Translate, and so you could immediately, just by putting that one little string of code in, you'd see your whole website in a different language. And the translation wouldn't be perfect, but you'd get the feeling. And that has been really effective in engaging their customers and kind of wowing them and also giving them something to go on while they go out and figure out who's going to translate and what languages they want and so on. And then the last thing is you need to give feedback. And that's really what a lot of, you know, this conference is about, is how do you provide feedback to your customers so they know that they're doing the right things, that you can identify when there's a problem and help them solve the problem before they get frustrated. If you take a step back and you look at the bigger picture of membership economy, I've mapped out seven things that companies can think about to really join this membership economy. And three of those, customer success, technology, and onboarding, are the ones that are most critical to generating and building relationships with super users. Customer success, I'm preaching to the choir here. Most of the time, I am not preaching to the choir. And most companies that I work with don't have customer success groups in their organization yet. And you see this problem, and I'm sure you all have experienced this in other companies, that after the transaction happens, even though the company is expecting to have a forever relationship with their new customer, that it's going to be a subscription model, it's going to be beautiful, it's going to go on forever, they haven't actually thought about who's going to make sure they're successful? Who's going to solve their problems as they arise? Who's going to take an interest and manage the data to see if there's a problem and help to solve it? Who's got that blend of support, professional services, a little bit of marketing, a little bit of sales, all mixed together to really take care of the customer? So that's one big thing that's needed. Second is the technology to support it, which is really the purpose of Totango and the topics that we've come here to talk about today. How do you track the data? How do you not just have it off somewhere, but how do you actually apply it and use it when it's needed? And then finally, how do you make sure that those first experiences that your customers are having when they're onboarded, that those experiences actually lead to a successful experience? Because those first 30 days are critical. And we spend time on the first 30 days with our employees, but most organizations aren't as thoughtful about what those first 30 days are going to be like for their customers. The membership economy and super users, you know, these SaaS companies are among the first to really understand these trends, but we see it in a lot of different places. I'm seeing mainstream membership businesses that are really trying to apply more technology and be more thoughtful about how they relate to their customers. Small businesses and consulting firms now are looking at subscription models and membership models for their very small businesses. Nonprofits, professional associations, organizations with loyalty programs are totally revamping their loyalty programs. In most cases, their loyalty programs aren't about loyalty at all. They're about member rewards, rewarding people for buying a certain volume. So they're rethinking that. It's everywhere we look. And that's very exciting to me. I would predict that customer success is going to become increasingly important, not just in technology companies, but in a whole range of companies. I'm going to leave you with four questions, since Passover is just around the corner. The first is, think about what is the ongoing forever benefit that you're providing? Because in the membership economy, the idea is the person joins and they expect you to solve some kind of problem or provide them with some kind of value forever. And so you need to really know what is that, because they don't want to leave. When they sign up for a subscription, it is their hope that they don't have to cancel. Nobody wants to cancel. They want to get the value. Second thing is to think about how you would treat your customers differently if they were members. The third is to think about how your customers would feel if they were members, if they really felt like this was a forever transaction. And then finally, I'd invite you to all think about who your super users are and how do you build more of them through your onboarding process and through the experiences that you provide them. I've written a book on this topic, which goes into a lot more detail, and I welcome you to read all about it. I'm also going to be here for the rest of the day, so I'm happy and, in fact, eager to talk to you and hear your feedback and get to know you a little bit. So with that, I'll close out and say thanks very much for your attention.